Hello everyone, this is Mohan Kumar. Today we will be talking about role of lipids in membrane fluidity, specifically in plasma membrane. So, we all know most systems in the universe are in a constant flux. They're always moving. That is how they're evolving, they're adapting. So is the case with our cell membranes as well. So here, as we understood in our previous class about the fluid nature of plasma membrane, that is having a bilayered phospholipid layer with studded proteins, making it more mosaic. So this mosaic nature is what gives asymmetry to the membrane. And this asymmetry again, because of addition of certain molecules like cholesterol, would make it more fluid. So the membrane is fluid here. So the fluid is a substance that continually deforms under an applied shear stress or external force. But because of the presence of cholesterol, the melting temperature of the plasma membrane, if it goes above or below, is actually brought back and made it more stable by the cholesterol molecules. Now we shall understand how other molecules also would play a role in fluidity before we jump in to understand the role of lipids in membrane fluidity. So how do lipid bilayer components move? Now, one of the tenets of the fluid mosaic membrane model is that the components of the bilayer are free to move. And before describing the differences between lipid and protein movement in the bilayer, it is important that we consider the types of movement possible in lipids alone first. So using phospholipids as an example, the first type of movement is rotational. Here the phospholipid rotates on its own axis to interact with its immediate neighbors. The second type of movement is lateral, where the phospholipid moves around in one leaflet. See here, the phospholipid is moving laterally on only one side of the plasma membrane. So this is called a leaflet. So finally, it is possible for phospholipids to move between both leaflets of the bilayer in transverse movement in a flip-flop manner, like this one, from here, from the lower leaflet to the upper leaflet, shifting over from one layer to another layer. So this lateral movement is what provides the membrane with a fluid structure. And how do we measure the lateral movement? By labeling the single particles and following their movement via high speed videography, we can discover that the phospholipids did not move via Brownian motion, erratic motion, but rather by hop diffusion. That is, they diffuse out and get localized in one place for a while, and then again they diffuse out. phospholipids stay in one region for a short while before hopping to another location. This compartmentalization of lateral movement appears to be linked to contacts between the actin cytoskeleton and the membrane, which form the regions that the phospholipids hop between. Membrane asymmetry is critical for membrane functions. So transfer movement is what allows the asymmetry to be maintained. Uncatalyzed movement of phospholipids between the bilayers is possible, but this is very, very slow and cannot be relied upon to maintain the asymmetry equilibrium. Instead, lipid translocator proteins catalyze the phospholipid movement between the bilayers. Say, for example, this phospholipid to move from here to here, there are enzymes like flipases. Flipases move phospholipids from outer leaflet to the inner leaflet. So, from the outer leaflet to the inner leaflet, flipases move. So, in order to maintain the charge gradient across the membrane, flipases predominantly transport phosphatidylserine and to a lesser extent phosphatidyl ethanol. Whereas flopases, see, as I said earlier, this is a flip-flop movement. So flipping is from outer to inner. So flopases move phospholipids in the opposite direction, particularly the colline-derived phospholipids, phosphatidylcholine and sphingomyelin, are moved from inner leaflet to the outer leaflet. So, flopases also mediate cholesterol transport from the intracellular monolayer to the extracellular monolayer. So, the cholesterol also flip from the inner leaflet to the outer leaflet by flopases. Flopases also, as I said, mediate cholesterol transport from the intracellular monolayer to the extracellular monolayer. These catalyzed movements are typically dependent on energy utilization, that is by ATP hydrolysis. A third class of proteins are the scramblases, which exchange phospholipids between the two leaflets in a calcium activated ATP independent process. So it is no energy utilization takes place, but it is calcium activated. The enzyme scramblases move the phospholipids between two leaflets. So, but this movement is measured in particular seconds. A flexion, that is the tail of the phospholipids, would flex in around 10 to the power minus 9 seconds. Okay. A lateral shift can take place in 10 to the power minus 6 seconds. Okay, this is in a nanoseconds, it's in a microseconds. And transfer diffusion can take place in 10 to the power minus 5 seconds. However, this is happening. See, each of these movement is happening in 1 by a lakh of a second, 1 by 10 lakh of a second, 1 by billionth of a second. How do we measure this? See, it is very easy to say that, you know, this happens in this seconds, but to measure this, to know that this is so fast, we require certain instruments to measure their movement. So what are the instruments? Well, although it is out of the syllabus, I just added this slide so that you get an idea what techniques are used to measure the lipid movement in that particular second. It need not be just lipids, you can also measure the proteins, you can measure any biomolecular interactions which is happening at that time window. Say 10 to the power 14 seconds, more than second, this is CST vibration, usually infrared or Raman spectroscopy can measure it for you. Lipid rotation, lateral hopping and protein rotation can happen between 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 2 seconds. This can be calculated via 2D electron-electron double resonance spectroscopy or electron spin resonance spectroscopy, electron paramagnetic spin resonance spectroscopy can be applied. Even fluorescence spectroscopy, phosphorescence depolarization methods, NMRs can also be applied to measure all this. But flip-flop is so fast. It is happening at 10 to the power minus 6 or 10 to the power minus 5, fifth of a second. Okay, so that will be 1 in 10 lakh. If you split a second in 10 lakh parts, so within that single part, the flip-flop is actually happening. So how do you measure that? There are methods. So one such method I would say, which is not mentioned here, is the time-resolved fluorescence spectroscopy. You label a molecule and then you measure it in nano level or even pico level of a second can be measured. So fluidity, how does the unsaturated fatty acids would make the membrane more fluid? So we all know unsaturated fatty acids are made up of double bonds. Here in this picture, if you see, the double bonds of a oleic acid can be easily identified at this junction in a carbon skeleton structure. So that is why, because of the double bond, there is a kink which is formed. So at an angle of 45 degree centigrade, so this molecule is not straight like stearic acid. So where there are no double bonds, it is saturated fatty acid. So no double bond, so the chain is linear. So how does this help? So the double bond forms a 45 degree kink or a bend in the hydrocarbon chains. This makes it difficult to arrange, as we see in this picture. See, because of the kink, what we see here, what we saw here in oleic acid, because of the kink, there is a space which is formed. The space would actually makes it more membrane, more fluid. But if there are no space, unlike stearic acid, see, the membrane becomes more viscous. There is no space in between, so they are compactly placed. But the fluidity is provided by this double bonds in the unsaturated fatty acids. So this is one such example. And the other molecule which brings about fluidity is the cholesterol. The plasma membrane contains a large number of cholesterol molecules in its structure. These cholesterol molecules orient themselves in a lipid bilayer in such a way that their hydroxyl group remains close to head groups of phospholipids. See, the cholesterol is closer to the head group. Due to this interaction, the rigid plate-like sterol rings, this is the sterol ring of cholesterol, would partly immobilize the polar head group of the phospholipids, leaving the rest of the hydrocarbon flexible. This hydrocarbon chain remains flexible because this is more rigid. Hence, it promotes the fluidity of the plasma membrane. Cholesterol also prevents the crystallization of the membrane by preventing hydrocarbon chains from coming together and crystallizing. Thus, cholesterol enhances the flexibility of plasma membrane. So, because of the space between the stearic rings, this would also make it more fluid. The membrane becomes more fluid in nature because of the spaces provided. So, and after understanding how an unsaturated fatty acids and a cholesterol would play a role in providing the fluidity for the membrane, it is the turn of proteins, membrane proteins. And these proteins, membrane proteins, are much more variable than lipid molecules in their mobility, and they also appear to move freely within the lipid bilayer, whereas others are constrained. Some are constrained, some are able to move freely. The constrained ones are usually the ones which integral proteins are constrained, whereas the peripheral proteins are not so constrained because they are anchored to the protein complexes located adjacent to one side of the membrane or the other. In case of membrane proteins, they are able to undergo rotational and lateral movement. However, there is no transfer movement of proteins between the leaflets. Intrinsic membrane proteins are tightly embedded in the hydrophobic core, whereas extrinsic membrane proteins are associated with their required leaflet. Intrinsic membrane here is the integral protein, whereas extrinsic are the peripheral proteins. Let's say the energy required to move either type of the membrane protein across the bilayer will be excessive. Specifically, membrane proteins require a lot of energy to move them from one place to another place. So what evidence would provide that the membrane proteins move in the plasma, on the plasma membrane? This experiment called cell fusion experiment, where a mouse cell and a human cell is taken, and each of these proteins are labeled with different colors. When we hybridize the cell, like when we fuse those cells using a Sendai virus, so the single cell which is formed after the fusion will have the multiple proteins, but the proteins tend to aggregate equidistant from each other. So if you see these different colors, you know, they are equally distributed all over the surface of the plasma membrane. So that confirms that the proteins have moved and arranged themselves in equidistant or apart from each other, from both mouse proteins and also human cell proteins. So having understood both lipids and the protein mobility within the plasma membrane, and we need to understand what role does it play in fluidity. So membrane fluidity seems to provide a perfect compromise between a rigid ordered structure in which the mobility would be absent, and a completely fluid non-viscous liquid in which the components of the membrane could not be oriented. So at present, it has been confirmed that the lipids, proteins as well as carbohydrates are asymmetrically distributed in the membrane instead of having a simple and symmetrical position or distribution. See, what is the inner leaflet and outer leaflet of the plasma membrane having a different composition? Sometimes the proteins on the external outer leaflet would be much higher, and sometimes only the internal leaflet of the plasma membrane, bilayered phospholipid layer, it's quite high in density of the proteins or even lipid. So it creates a condition called asymmetrical distribution of lipids and proteins. So they are not symmetrically equally distributed, they are unequal in its distribution. So that asymmetrical or unequal distribution or molecular organization has actually evolved to satisfy the functional properties of the membrane. So it would aid in certain physiology and functions of the cell specifically. So based on that requirement, the membrane becomes more asymmetrical in nature. So it allows the membrane proteins to rapidly move. So the fluidity would allow the membrane proteins to rapidly move, align, cluster or diffuse in the plane of the bilayer. So the fluidity allows for interactions to take place within the membrane. Example, cluster of membrane proteins to assemble at particular sites with the membrane to form specialized structures such as intercellular junction, light capture complexes and synapses, or even lipid wraps. You can take that also as an example. So lipid wraps are formed only when there is a requirement for the cell to receive a particular signal. They form a flash shaped structure called caveolae, or even independent cluster of cholesterol and lipids and proteins coming together to enhance the interaction of protein and to carry out the signal transduction cascade inside the cell. So it permits membrane lipids and proteins to diffuse from sites where they are inserted into bilayer after the synthesis, this maintaining the asymmetry of the plasma membrane. This I spoke about quite a lot. So it enables membranes to fuse with one another and mix their molecules. A cell fusion experiment would be a good example in this regard. It ensures that membrane molecules are distributed evenly between daughter cells when a cell divides. So many of basic cellular processes, including cell movement, cell growth, secretion, endocytosis, depend on the movement of membrane components and would probably not be possible if membranes were rigid and non-fluid in nature. So fluidity plays a huge role in normalizing and optimizing the cellular physiology. And this finishes the role of lipids in membrane fluidity. And thank you very much for your patience listening. If you have any doubts, you can leave it on the comment box or you can reach me on my WhatsApp number. Thank you very much.